Today we're continuing on with Understanding the Kingdom Part 8, and we're still trying to get out of Genesis. But I want to go back to Genesis chapter 6, picking up in verse 5. I don't think that for us to prepare for the days ahead, we have got to. God said, I'm going to teach you the end from the beginning. And there are many scriptures that talk about as it was in the days of old, so shall it be. When Jesus talked about as in the days of Noah, there's so much in that one statement. But we discovered that this dual combination of giving man forbidden knowledge and beginning to modify his DNA did something on the inside of man. In Genesis 6, 5, and it saw that God saw the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart were only continually evil. It almost kind of sounds like today, doesn't it? There is an expansion of evil in planet earth. Now, the Amplified reads a little bit differently, but I like the variation it brings. And the Lord saw the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination and intention of all human thinking was only evil continually. And you know, there's a lot of things, as I see politicians and others talking and saying things on earth, they may be saying the right sound bites. But if you have spiritual discernment with many of them, the intention of their heart is evil. They have used sound bites, whether they're science or in industry or in politics or with the UN or whatever, or many times just news agencies, that there is a hidden agenda. And what the Bible tells us, that hidden agenda in Genesis was that their intents of their heart was always to produce an evil, and they would do externally whatever they needed to do to bring about that evil. What we see in Genesis 6 was that the kingdom of darkness was about to take over planet Earth. I'm in the middle of writing my sequel to Examining the Son of Perdition, and one of the things we need to understand, now we've touched on this, is that when Lucifer fell, that iniquity was found, it was discovered in him. He used the five I wills to produce a false grace, and it created what the Holy Spirit keeps on telling me is the iniquity force. And that when man fell and Lucifer became the god, little g, of this earth, that he released this force called iniquity. It was embedded into the hearts of men, and that as mankind grew and as that darkness grew, what the watchers did, they came and with this little fire of iniquity, or as the elite would say, fire within the minds of men, that the Prometheus is a watcher, and so he gave the fire of the gods, if you will, to man. And what the watchers did is they came and threw gasoline on it. I believe, just like they're doing in this day and this hour, that there is spiritual dark gasoline being thrown onto the evil in the hearts of men today. And when you look at the very foundation of the UN, they're Luciferian at their very core. And so they are planning in stages of this, increasing this darkness, increasing this darkness. Can we understand that? Then we begin understanding the days of Noah, we begin to understand the very days that we're going to face. And I also believe that when we read what happened with Noah, we're going to begin discovering the tasks that are before us. And it's so important. But we go on here in verse 6. It got so bad that it repented the Lord that he had made man on the earth. Can you imagine things getting so bad that God says, you know, I really kind of wish I hadn't created man at all. I made him in my image. I made him for my glory. But he's so far from that now, I kind of wish I hadn't done it. That's how corrupt the hearts and the minds of men had become. In verse 7, and the Lord said, I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth, both man and beast and the creeping thing and the fowls of the air, for it repenteth me that I had made them." So there was something in all of this that goes beyond just even man, that they had corrupted so much more. Now, before I get into that, I want to get into something I pulled up this morning off Crossway, because we're talking about darkness and evil beginning to really explode in the hearts of men. And this is off Crossways or crosswalk.com. And it was written for pastors and for Christian counselors. And it's five indicators of an evil and a wicked heart, which I thought was very timely. The first one was an evil heart, or evil hearts are experts at creating confusion and contention. We can see that from the White House on down. We can see that from the organized labor on down. We can see that between nations. We can see that going on today. They want to create contention where we were hoping for peace and restoration. It's causing confusion and contention between the races, between the nations. Not only in this nation are we seeing an escalation rather than a de-escalation of tension between various races. At the same time, we're seeing tension between different nations. We have had the president of Russia basically send word to America, "We will nuke you." How many know that's not good? We're seeing China begin to gear up for war. We're seeing all these indicators, all this tension. When evil hearts begin to swell and begin to do their thing, they will always bring confusion and contention. Number two, evil hearts are experts at fooling others with their smooth speech and flattering words. Now, this article is not about politics, unless it's the politics that goes on in church. That's why I've said many times when some people go overboard on something that I've taught, or, Dr. Lake, this, that, and the other, I almost tense up. You know, there's a certain point where it goes beyond that which is normal. I tense up because I'm thinking, okay, are you patting my back way too much because you're trying to find the kink in my armor? And how many pastors have found that some of the very people that they were trying to help were the ones who planted the dagger the deepest in their backs? Evil hearts crave and demand control, and their highest authority is their self-reference. Ouch. They become legends in their own minds. Evil hearts play on the sympathies of goodwill people, often trumping the grace card. Well, it's grace. I can do what I want. It's grace. You got to do this. You know, sometimes, and guys, in the days ahead, and this is just between you and me and everybody who watches on YouTube, so I'm bringing all you guys into it too. Sometimes the best thing, there's coming a time that the best thing a pastor can do is show a few people the door. It's time that if you discern there is an evil heart there. You know, can you imagine trying to convert Jezebel? It might just be best to show Jezebel the door and said, "There's some dogs out there waiting on you." There's coming a time that as the ark begins to close for the days ahead, we turn from our mission of saving the lost to protecting the redeemed. There will be a time of that. Then there's to be a time again for expansion. Number five, an evil heart has no conscience or remorse. If all people do is give excuses for the stupid and the bad things they've done in the past instead of showing remorse for it, there's an evil heart there, not a repentant heart. I tell you what, there have been times in my own life, guys, that I, you know, nobody's ever seen me not quite respond correctly. You know, it's like I didn't really think it through, and sometimes the wound of the past will come up. Many of those still bother me to this day. I wish I could go back in time and say, you know, I said this and it was kind of right, but not completely right. Boy, I wish I could have done this. You know, it's like you go, oh boy, this. A person of an evil heart will never think that way. They'll point at somebody else and say, you know, I would have acted different, but it was them. Guys, we need to get this evil heart out. We need to be able to identify an evil heart compared to a heart. There's a difference in an evil heart, a wounded heart, a misguided heart, a confused heart. There's a big difference. It also goes on to say, here is what these evil-hearted people want you to believe. Their horrible actions should have no serious or painful consequences in others. They don't have to take responsibility for it. They come and bring in conflict and all these different things. But, you know, it's not their fault. And there comes a time, because I look at the book of Acts, and how many know we're returning to the book of Acts? Rome is in ascendancy. Okay. There was Ananias and Sapphira. How many know there were consequences for lying to the Holy Spirit? Because they wanted to be like another guy. They wanted to be a son of consolation. They wanted to give the appearance of selling everything that they had and gave it to the church. You know, there was no requirement in the book of Acts to do that. They could have said, Peter, we got a real good deal, and now what we're going to do is we're not going to give the tithe. Maybe we'll keep the tithe and we'll give God the 90%. They tried to present themselves as something they weren't and lied to God. How many know there are consequences for that? And there's coming a time there may be consequences once again. Some of the old games that used to go on in church, there may be consequences in the days ahead because the road is getting narrower in the days ahead. And this is so important for us to understand. And it also brings up that an evil person will always try to get you to believe that if I talk the gospel believing, if I talk like a gospel believing Christian, I am one, even if my actions don't line up with my talk. You know what? If your walk don't line up with your talk, you're in trouble. And that goes for all of us. And when our walk doesn't line up with our talk, it's time to hit our knees and begin to pray and to seek God because we're letting darkness creep in. But what's interesting in the judgment, not only was man judged, but also the animals. God says, I'm going to have to wipe out all the animals. How many of the only animals that survived except for those that are in the ocean, those that could swim, were destroyed too? And what's interesting, when we look at this, this is out of the book of Jasher. It gives us some very interesting insights. And this is in Jasher 18. And it said, their judges and rulers went to the daughters of men and took their wives by force from their husbands according to their choice. And the sons of men in those days from the cattle of the earth and of the beasts of the field and the fowls of the air and taught the mixture of one animal species with another. In other words, to provoke the Lord, and God saw the whole earth, and it was corrupt, for all flesh had corrupted its ways upon the earth of all men and all animals. Why is this important? Because as it was in the beginning, so shall it be in the end times. When you begin looking at what the transhumanists are wanting to do today, they're beginning to do the same thing. They are learning how to begin splicing DNA. Anybody ever heard that? Splicing DNA, resequencing DNA. The reason why they have started with plant life, genetically modified organism. You're getting a little frog in your corn now. They're splicing DNA, the genetic makeup of Roundup, into the DNA of that corn. And it's not going to stop there. They're already talking about genetically modifying animals. In fact, one I thought was the interesting is as I was talking with Josh Peck about, you know, God says not to eat swine. When Jesus comes back, he's going to judge the swine eaters and the mouse. And to me, I had never connected when I wrote the book Eating God's Way that mouse was a delicacy among pagan people with the Greeks and the Romans. Even a house mouse wasn't safe. It was just an hors d'oeuvre. But one of the things that they have done so that the byproduct of raising hogs, how many know that it's very toxic on the environment? It'll kill anything around it. So what they have done to lessen the toxicity is they have blended mouse DNA with swine DNA. And so you have pigs that are part mouse. Interesting, out of all the animals on planet Earth, they had to choose a mouse to blend with a pig to get the new super hog. Maybe you can just, maybe they just have little bigger ears, and if you see a pig with long whiskers, it's the pig mouse. But guys, this is significant because we're next. You have certain animals like with apes or orangutans and different ones that for their muscle, for their size, their muscle mass is more dense and more strong. You know, orangutan could rip your arm off. It could be the size of a man, yet its strength is so much that if it would grab it, literally yank your arm clean off your body. Well, imagine just giving a super soldier a little bit of orangutan or a little bit of ape, and maybe to give him night vision, we can give him a little of this, and to give him more endurance, we can give him this. That's the super soldier program. And one of the things that Tom Horn and others have been talking about, when you begin tweaking the DNA and you begin bringing foreign DNA from other animals, what is the point that you begin altering the very way that they perceive reality? That they begin more thinking as an animal rather than someone created in the image of God. You see, that was part of what we see going on, and I can see literally Lucifer trying to build an army. He was going to stop a line from Messiah coming, because if this would have continued, everything on planet Earth would have been corrupted. How would the one that was going to come and crush the Nehesh's head ever come if there was not a line that he could be birthed from? They were all no longer human. The image of God had been erased off the earth. God's fingerprint on this planet would have been replaced with the fingerprint of Lucifer, and it's happening again today. We need to be aware. But when we go on in verse 8, this is what verse 8 and 9 is some very powerful information. But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. How about that grace in the Old Testament? I thought grace was just a New Testament thing. Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. And these are the generations of Noah. For Noah was a just man and perfect in his generation, and Noah walked with God. So there's a couple of things I want to look at. Number one, grace was in the Old Testament. How many know the reason that Adam and Eve survived beyond God showing up in the garden? Because he basically told them, you eat of that fruit, you're dead. How many know Almighty God cannot lie? He had every right to wipe them out in the garden and start anew. Well, I'm just going to have to look for some better dirt, I guess, and do it all over again. But yet in the garden, he said, you guys really messed up, and there's consequences for it. But the grace was, I'm going to send one of the seed of the woman. Although the enemy is going to bruise his heel, he's going to crush his head. I think from that day forward, the Nehesh felt a long headache beginning to brew that he can't get rid of. And every day he has that headache, he's saying, one of these days, the heel of Jesus is going to absolutely crush my head and destroy me. And so he began to use that dark knowledge that he promised to so corrupt mankind. But one of the things that really stuck out to me is we think, you know, you read this when you really understand what's going on, and we're going to get into here in a minute that one of the things about Noah, he was perfect in his generations, he was still 100% human. But that's not the only reason that God chose him. This word find, that he found grace in the eyes of the Lord, is mashdah in Hebrew, which means to find, to attain, to secure, to acquire, or to get, or things sought after. And here's the lesson for us. How many know we're saved by grace? So you get a little dab of grace when you get saved, and now we're taught that's all the grace there is. You see, that grace gave you the power to become the sons of God, to become sons and daughters of the Most High, so that grace you get your foot into the kingdom. And what we have confused, what we have told ourselves, is that's all the grace of God there is. How many know that you have to have more? There are more levels of God's grace, more levels of God's power. Grace is not an excuse to sin. Grace is the power of God, not only to overcome sin, but to walk in the kingdom. And there are levels of grace. Noah was not only a pure human, it says that he walked with God and he pushed into God so that he was finding greater levels of grace. That grace was greater than the darkness that was in the earth. That he knew he is going to have to require of himself to draw from greater levels of the well of God's grace to enable him to withstand the darkness that was out there. And in the same way, church, we've got to wake up. We have got a little thimbleful of grace, and we said, once saved, always saved. Salvation is no longer the issue once you're saved. It's how do I get deeper into this thing? I have tasted and I have found that the Lord is good, and now I want to get deeper in Him. I want to get deeper in that grace. I want to get deeper in the kingdom. I want to get deeper in the Word. And what we have done is we have treated grace like the little old dippity-doo hairstyle they used to have, a little dabble do you? Or was that, what was Brill Cream or one of them? I can't remember which one it was. I'm pulling way back from the 1990s. But you did this little dab of grace, and you don't realize that you got a little thimbleful, and God is offering you an ocean. The true grace. The deeper you walk in grace, the less sin is in your life. The deeper you walk in grace, the more of Jesus that you'll find. The deeper you go in grace, the less that iniquity and darkness has within you. And it gets to the place that you become a light in the earth, and you begin repelling the darkness. That's what God is needing, because we're going to have to withstand the iniquity force being in ascension on this planet. That's what God is requiring of us. And so Noah is our example, that he acquired grace, that he sought after grace, that he attained grace in the eyes of God. He was so deep in God that God says, you know what? When I judge the earth, I can't judge you. Now, some people look at the ark and the story of Noah as a thing of the rapture. But I need to remind you that he was left in the earth. God created a safe place in the midst of judgment. Now, I'm not going to argue pre-trib, mid-trib, or post-trib. Whenever Jesus wants to come back, my job is to be ready to go and for me to hold the fort and to represent him to the best of my ability before he comes. Not to be setting on my blessed assurance, but to be laboring in the kingdom. That's our task. And so we need to, you know, let's quit arguing about, is this a salvation issue? Get out of kindergarten. I'm saved by the blood of Jesus, and that it is his completed work that has brought me into the kingdom. Now my job is to grow in him and learn to function in his kingdom, to where I'm giving him more and more and more of my life, and that everything in my life, spirit, soul, and body, is surrendered before the king, and then I begin to move in his authority in the earth, because I've got to contrast the kingdom of darkness with a fully, you know, if the kingdom of darkness is going to fully manifest, how about God having a right through some of his people to fully manifest the kingdom? That's what I'm after. And it's time for us to grow up. The next time somebody says, is this a salvation issue? I want to slap them, because it's time for you to get out of kindergarten, or you should be in your second year of graduate school, and you're still playing with little Tonka trucks in the kindergarten of the kingdom, wearing little knickers, because you refuse to grow up. Get saved, be sure in your salvation, and now go on. Is this a salvation issue? Well, maybe if you're dealing with that, maybe you're not as saved as you think you are. Just want to say. Noah was perfect in his generations. This word is tamim in the Hebrew, which means to be made complete, whole, entire, sound, fully health, soundful, healthful, innocent, having integrity. And it's the same word whenever they begin looking for a sacrifice that had to be perfect. It was tamim. That he was completely human. He had not been tainted by what they had done in his spirit, in his mind, or in his body. And that's our task. And how many know it's going to take work? I mean, I pray over the vaccines. Because you know how much DNA alteration they have done in the vaccines? Not only in many of the vaccines is there, did they use aborted fetuses, babies that were murdered to create the line. They also put a little monkey in there and a little bit of this and a little bit of that in the vaccines. And one of the things that concerns me, because I don't think those were necessary to create immunity for a certain disease. I think that's additional junk they put into it for another nefarious purpose. I think the concept of vaccines is good. You get, you know, it's like you take a certain line of germs, you kill the germ, you introduce it to the body in a dead place, in a dead way that it can't take over, and your immune system responds by building antibodies for that. But why do we need altered DNA in the mix? Why do we need thimerosal and mercury and some of these things? It's all the other junk. It's the witch's brew they have added to a true concept that concerns me. And many times the worst form of vaccines are not the ones that you go to the doctor and pay good money for. It's the ones they give free, part of the health care program. You know, like if you're on welfare, you get the real witch's brew. Or like we're seeing in many other nations where they're going in and vaccinating the people. We have a founder of one of the biggest software companies that is now, and it sounds good, you know, they're helping vaccinate the world. Did you know that there are places right now that the people are raising up and killing the doctors that are coming in because so many of their children are dying from it? And I don't think it's from the basic truth. I think sometimes they give way too many at one time, but I also think it's the other junk that they put in there, not the basics of what vaccines should be. That's just my opinion. But the very last thing here is Noah walked with God. While everybody else was walking with the instruction of the watchers, was walking and all, both the book of Enoch and the book of Jasher says men hungered for that knowledge. Men sought after that knowledge. Isn't it the same way today? Men are seeking after that knowledge in an unprecedented way. We're going to see that very little goes on planet Earth that was not given from the kingdom of darkness in one way or another, except for the kingdom that is established in this book. This is the antithesis to the world system right here. And yet the Christian has been so duped that we take out of our consideration the first two-thirds of God's antidote for the kingdom of darkness. I like what A.W. Tozer said, it takes a whole Bible to make a whole Christian. Genesis through the book of Revelation. That's our target. That's what we're after. Now, the end time application here. Guys, we are in a period in which the iniquity force of Lucifer is in ascension in the earth. The minute you say anything about the Bible right now, even in America, you're in trouble. I used to be in the military. We used to talk about God all the time. We now have a one-star general in the Air Force that was at a prayer breakfast that talked about how that he depended upon Jesus and upon the Word of God. He's being court-martialed. At a prayer breakfast, not at a staff meeting, not at any official military thing where they're war planning, and he didn't say, well, let me tell you about Jesus while we're planning on bombing, you know, whatever. It was at a prayer breakfast. Well, then what else are you going to talk about but God at a prayer breakfast? He's being court-martialed. I read a story this week about a woman in the Marine Corps. I don't know if she was just a private or whatever, but she had a scripture that she was memorized. She made a little sign, "No weapon formed against me shall prosper." How many of that might be good for a Marine to stand on, especially if they're going to go into combat? She's being court-martialed for it. That is ridiculous. But yet it's being manifest. It's being manifested in society. If you stand up for this book and you begin proclaiming, God says this is good, God says this is wrong, there's repercussions for that now in the media, every place. It's as it was in the days of Noah. Do you think Noah got up and preached righteousness and repentance for 120 years and he got a standing ovation? Or was he ridiculed and mocked and scorned by men whose hearts were only evil? So what we've got to do is we've got to learn the keys of overcoming the same way that Noah did. Number one, we have got to strive to find the true grace of God and stay in it and grow in it. Our job is not a little dabble, do you? Our job is to get deep in the grace of God, deep in the Word of God, and deep in the Holy Spirit as we can get and stay there. And the marvelous thing about God is that you never arrive until you stand before Him in glory. As long as you're in this earth, there are deeper places to go in God. There's greater righteousness to be released in your life. There's greater understanding of the Word of God. I have been studying the Word of God all my life. And one of the things in the last 10 years as I have discovered is the more I learn, the more I realize how much more there is to learn. That's one of the reasons within the ancient sages of Israel, instead of being called doctors or becoming master teachers, they were called sages. And a sage in Hebrew means master learner. That they finally got to the place where now they could really, really learn. And I think that's where God's wanting to get us. We've got to learn. We've got to reject the ways of the kingdom of darkness and stay true to the kingdom of God by walking in the ways of God. You see, there's some work to be done. After Noah heard from God and said, "There's something bad coming." Has anybody heard a prophet of God say, "There's something bad coming"? All you got to do is turn on Christian radio. Something bad is coming. Well, imagine Noah and his sons sitting back saying, "Well, we're just going to trust God. Okay, something bad's coming. I'm going to roll up my sleeves, and it's time to work." If ever there was a time to work, to push into God, to push into the Word, and for us to overcome our inadequacies that have held us back, this is the day and the hour to do it. What if Noah's sons were lazy? How many know building an ark, there's no time to be lazy on that. They had to push through some things. This is a time to walk with God and not to be enthralled in the world system. We're going to have to unwind ourselves. We're going to have to untangle ourselves from the world system. Let's go on. In verse 11, it says, "The whole of the earth also was corrupt before the Lord, and the earth was filled with violence." Is the earth filled with violence today? Just turn on your news. From Chicago to Baghdad and every place in between on both sides. "And the Lord looked upon the earth and beheld it was corrupt, and all flesh was has corrupted his ways, his way upon the earth." Now there's several ways of looking at this. Not only was the flesh corrupted, but they corrupted the way of God. Because you can look at this and say, God looked and he saw his way corrupted upon the earth. Is God's way being corrupted upon the earth by the way people are preaching today? In society, have they corrupted it? At the same time, if he's looking at saying the men have corrupted their ways, it's how you live, it's what you believe. If what you believe is not strong enough to change what you're doing, you don't believe. Our belief has to be strong enough that we begin organizing our lives and setting everything in order according to the kingdom. I think right now our lives are the place where we're going to have this showdown with Baal, like that Elijah had on Mount Carmel. And the Bible says that he took everything in the offering and he set everything in its place. Believer, is everything set in its place in your life? Are you where you need to be? Am I as deep in God as I need to be? Am I letting the world influence too many things? Am I letting the candy-coated preaching of others still linger in my mind? Is it causing me to just be lackadaisical about my walk with God? Because one of the things God told me about here this morning, and I'm going to begin reorganizing everything to do it, this is going to be a place of prayer, of worship, of study, and of service. That's what it's going to be. That's what it's going to be with every aspect of biblical life, and I want it to be every aspect of my life. There's some changing coming. And no matter how high you think you've come in God, it's a small fraction of where you could be. That means, you know, deep talk calls unto deep. And let me tell you something. Right now, the darkness is getting deep. We got to crank up the light in our lives. We're going to have to make some decisions. As I look, why is this so important? Several things I'm looking at here. Now, I don't think we're yet to the place that man seeks to absolutely corrupt his DNA, although that path is being set today between the vaccines and the DNA experiments by DARPA and many other laboratories. I think we're well on our way. You know, why am I sharing this? Because I see, you know, there's people calling me, the Lord may come back in September. Now, if he wants to, he doesn't need my permission. He can just come back anytime he wants to. But what I see both in the Word and what I see with what the Luciferian elite are planning, I think they're planning World War III right now. That's not the Magog and Magog War. They're planning a worldwide riots of wars of religion, Islam, Christianity, Judaism. All of them are going to end up in this war because of radical Islam. They're feeding this. There's even evidence that maybe even parts of our own government are helping feed and establish ISIS. Dark projects. Mary and I were listening to Perry Stone when he was on True News. And Perry Stone says, I have friends in Washington that tell me that there are two Washingtons. One that loves God and loves the Constitution. One that hates God and hates the Constitution. That's very, very dark. And I think we're supercharged by the Nazis after World War II when we brought them all in. We didn't convict them and try them and hang them all. The best of them, the cream of the crop, was seeded into all the nations and the allied nations. And so they brought their occultic philosophies in with them, and that's been feeding. There's evidence right now that there are aspects of America that is very Nazi-like, and it alarms me. That wants to do away with the Constitution, that wants to do away with the Word of God, that wants to turn this into an occult utopia. That's Nazi. They're looking still to build the Third Reich. I got news for you. The only true Reich is going to be the reign of Jesus when he reigns for 1,000 years on the earth. So we see all this. And I see past that. The Bible talks about a great delusion. Can you imagine the world on the precipice of extinction, except for the elite that already have underground bases for them to live at, but they don't bring into the equation earthquakes and things like that. Hint, hint. But they're looking for all this to happen. While they're in their underground bunkers, in their cities that are fortified with military forces to protect them, while humanity begins to wipe out itself so it can fulfill the Georgia stones to reduce the world's population to where it's more manageable, and when it looks like the earth is on the brink of destruction, the watchers are going to return with a hybrid leader that is supernaturally empowered. Everybody's sick of religion. Christians have been deceived. And they're sick of all this stuff. They're going to blame Christianity. They're going to blame Judaism. They're going to rebuke every religion except for Luciferianism. And then they're going to have this crown prince of Luciferian arise. We're going to call him the Antichrist. What a great delusion. And they're going to come back and say, well, we created you. Evolutionists have already bought into this. They have already established panspermia. That they took the apes or whatever, and they tweaked the DNA to create man. And they say, since we're your progenitors, we're here now to take you the next step before you destroy yourselves. And here's our proof of what, now if you let us do what we need to do with you, here is what you can do. And then he gets in the temple of God and he declares himself to be God. Very, very plausible. Especially when you look at what is being done by the Vatican right now on Mount Graham. Dr. Horn has some wonderful documentaries on that. That with the telescopes and the different things they have, the highest technology, one of them is called the Lucifer device, which I think is a very interesting acronym. That Malachi Martin said, and he was a Jesuit that got out, and I think he was killed shortly after the publishing of his book, The Jesuits. He said, on that mountain, which the Indians believe is a portal to higher dimensional realities, they say that they've been watching something come toward the earth. Some of their key astrologers, now they have poured millions if not billions of dollars into this place, so this is not some little quirky thing I'm talking about. They have went on record, years ago they were saying that we have been baptizing aliens into the faith. Now they're saying this, that when they show up, not if, when they show up, they will most likely baptize us and show us all where we're erring on the gospel. Where the conversation stopped with this guy, one of the key leaders, astrophysicist, one of the top ones in the world that's part of the Vatican. Tom Horn asked him, he says, are you telling me that you're about ready to share that what the Immaculate Conception was nothing more than an alien abduction, and that Jesus was a hybrid is why he could do what he did? Kind of ended the conversation after that, but that's the direction they're going. Now you can say, Mike, this is all horse feathers. Maybe. We're dealing with speculative eschatology. But what I am saying is there's some darkness coming, however it's going to be. And in this day and in this hour, we have got to take our lessons from Noah. You've got to build your own ark. By establishing yourself in the kingdom of God to learn how to get deeper in grace than you've ever got. It's time to quit the excuses. It's time to hit every bondage full head on with the bulldozer of the Holy Spirit, not be satisfied till there's nothing left of it because we got to go on. We're going to have to learn how to walk with God and his power. We're going to have to return to biblical holiness and the power of God while the whole earth is turning toward iniquity and corruption. Right now, most of the church is floating downstream in the stream of iniquity and is flowing right along with it. We got to get out of that stream and get back into the stream of God. We must labor and put forth real effort into these things to prepare for the day ahead. Now, here's a word of warning. The seeking, learning, pushing through, and developing is an individual family unit thing. Noah's, and this is one of the things that just amazes me. All right, Noah's sons work, dad had this vision, dad's walking with God, so I'm riding on the coattails of dad. And there's some evidence, according to some people that researched the lineage, think that Noah's wife was actually the daughter of Enoch. How many know that was a family that walked with God? But the sons rode on the coattails. They saw the wrath of God. They saw God destroy this planet of everything except what was in that ark. And yet when they get out, one of them, his line brought forth Nimrod, established Babylon, and established Egypt. Only one line, Shem, really walked with God, and Japheth kind of bounced between the two brothers. He wasn't near as good as Shem, and he wasn't near as bad as Ham. But he's kind of, they didn't learn. They didn't, only Shem developed his own walk with God. He got off of Noah's coattails and said, you know what? If God did it before, God may do it something worse next time. I'm digging into God and I'm pressing into God. And it's from the line of Shem that Messiah comes. It's time to get off people's coattails. One of the most powerful things, statements you'll miss with Isaac. Isaac unstopped. The enemies of God and the enemies of Abraham had come through and stopped up all the wells that he dug. First Isaac unstops all those. It's time to return to some good old-fashioned preaching of the gospel. It's time to preach the cross. It's time to preach holiness again. And all those things the enemy has stopped. Preachers, in fact, I have heard guys, and listening to Rick Wiles and some others, there are places these men are not invited. When God gave him the message that he was to do with true news, many Christian airwaves, would not allow him on because he was preaching repentance. The well of repentance has been stopped up by the enemies of God. The wells of biblical holiness have been stopped up by the enemies of God. It's time for us to unearth those and to redig those wells. But Lot didn't stop, or Isaac didn't stop there. He went and dug some of his own too. It's time for us to undig some of the wells like Lester Sumrall had, and that Smith Wigglesworth had, and that Spurgeon had, and that other great men of God had, that Wesley had. Wesley would preach the holiness of God so strong and so real that people feared that they were going to fall into hell at that very moment because they realized how undone they were before a holy God, and then he would preach the cross. My God, how we need that again today. But there's also some wells in the last generation that have yet to be dug. It's our task to unstop these first and get solid in them and to dig for some newer wells, because we're going to have to face some greater things than Spurgeon did, or that Wesley did, or Finney did, or Lester Sumrall. There's some things that's going to be straight out of sci-fi novels. They go all the way back to what was in the days of Noah. As we were in prayer this morning, and it was so real to me. The tallit, the prayer shawl, is a type and symbol of two things. Number one, it's a type and symbol of the anointing of ministry. That an Old Testament type and shadow is when Elijah ascended, his mantle descended for Elisha to have, which is a type and shadow of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Elisha did greater works than Elijah. He did twice as many. In fact, the only place he fell short was when he died, he was short raising twice as many people from the dead as Elijah did. So there was a time of battle, a guy was wounded, they were running from the enemy, they threw this dead guy into the cave where Elisha's bones were, and when that dead corpse hit Elisha's bones, that guy came back running out of the cave. God is faithful. He did greater works. I'm looking for those greater works. So the tallit represents the greater works. I can take every corner and every aspect of a true biblical tallit and to teach you about Christ. I can see the Apostle Paul saying, listen, the stripes upon his back that I'm healed there, these are the wings of Messiah. This is the blue cord. This is, you can't keep the commandments of God. You can't have the name of God within you or anything unless it's all intertwined in Messiah. It's literally when you put that tallit on your shoulders, it is a visceral representation of putting on Christ. And so as we were praying this morning, I saw Jesus just dropping tallits, and they were kind of floating down like how a dove would float. And as it landed on the individual, it would entwine itself into their armor, and all of a sudden that armor was augmented. You may have had some armor that kind of did you, but when what's coming, you're going to need some stronger armor. And it's the anointing that comes from Jesus. It's putting on Christ in a greater way than you ever have before. That is our task in this day and this hour. It is time to quit playing games. It's time to quit playing church. Because the last thing you want to do is start building the ark when the floodwaters come. You better be ship ready and ship tight when it comes and be ready for it. And that's the grace that God's giving in this hour. I believe it's a clarion call to press into God with all of our might to bring every bondage, to bring everything the enemy has ever tried to do in us and around us under our feet, and to see fully manifested within us who Jesus called us to be. And heaven is saying, I am releasing an anointing to bring it to pass in your life. If you seek me, I will give it. I will be a rewarder of those who diligently seek me. And so this is a time of seeking and depressing and to realigning our lives with heaven like never before. And when I do, I'm expecting an increase of wisdom, an increase of power, an increase of answered prayer, an increase of everything of the kingdom of God. That's what I want, and that's what God wants for every one of our lives. So if the enemy has ever convinced you on getting on somebody's coattails, it's time to step off, and it's time for you to build your own coattails. It's time for you to build your own place of walking with God. Now, Father, today in the name of Jesus, Father, I thank you that there is an anointing being released from heaven today. And Father, I ask that you would begin every person that hears my voice, that hears this message. Father, they may not agree with part of my interpretation of eschatology, and Father, that is actually academic. But what is true is it's time to press in because darkness is rising. And Father, it's rising because the church has stopped being salt in the earth. We have stopped being that preserving effect in the earth. And Father, it's time for that light to come. It's time for us to seek you with all of our hearts, to repent of every area of our lives, and to begin bringing kingdom order. And Father, to get deeper in your grace, deeper in your word, deeper in your spirit, deeper in the kingdom than ever before, so that we can have the light and the armor of God to withstand darkness in this day. And Father, I just release an anointing for those who are willing and will roll up their sleeves and go to work with the Holy Spirit. Father, I know it's going to come to pass in a powerful and real and manifested way. In Jesus' name.